crooked teeth, and possibly with that craniofacial form, seems to have changed relatively dramatically over a relatively short space of time. Few people's parents had their teeth straightened. And I can remember when I was at school, there was very few people who had any form of fixed or even removable braces within their mouth. And it was almost unheard of in my parents' era, now most people's grandparents' era. And I think we can safely say there's been a massive increase in the level of crooked teeth and malocclusion, and with that, a certain level of facial change. Now, why? It's always a very interesting question. Why? Now, I believe that oral posture, and there's exceptionally good evidence to suggest that oral posture is a key factor within this. And of course, oral posture tends to go with body posture in general. And if we go back to sort of grandparents and great-grandparent era, in Britain, this was the Victorian era, and I was asking some colleagues from Lithuania and Latvia what they called the Victorian era, and I was surprised that they called it the Victorian era. So the Victorian era is, it seems to be, it was fairly similar, I think, in many parts of the world. And images like this seem reminiscent of the Victorian era. The image of St. Martin's, which is a church that would allow people coming in, homeless people would come in, be given a meal, somewhere to sleep. It was part of that church's charitable contribution to the area it was in. And here's an image of everyone sitting there, bolt upright, and the same with these children. You know, that was the Victorian thing. You sat there, sat upright. What really interests me, and it started this thought process that I'm having, was this mealtime exercise. Elbows off the table, chew your food well, eat with your mouth closed. I'm adding the Mackenzie chin tuck, so sitting up back like that. Basic good table manners. And this is really harking back to this Victorian good body posture or day and good body posture for eating, particularly. And it really started to interest me. And so I started asking the parents of the patients that were coming in. I get patients from all over the world, and of course England, London particularly, is very multicultural. So even the patients I have from London have come from all four corners of the world. So I started asking parents what their parents were saying, you know, whether it was normal, this, you know, elbows off the table, sit up straight, eat with your mouth closed, whether that was normal in the cultures they'd come from. And I've had parents in, I think, from easily from all of those continents. I can't say I've had many indigenous people from South or North America or Australia, but definitely had people from all walks of life in all of those areas coming in to see me as patients that I've engaged in within the last year or two. And so far, every single parent of patient or adult patient has agreed that their parents or grandparents were trying to implement this simple routine. Sit up straight, elbows off the table, mouth closed. The same mantra was being said by groups from all of these countries. Now, stop for a second and think about the significance of this, because people left Africa to travel to all four corners of the world before we had tables and chairs. So how could this concept exist unless it's happened since our cultures diverged? Which realistically, it must be the best example I know of a parallel cultural evolution. So the same cultural phenomena, this sort of the mealtime mantra, we could call it, has seemed to evolve in all of the countries, all the way around the world, at in parallel, not necessarily at the same time, but probably similar times in relation to the change in culture that was going on. And it seemed very interesting. I mean, for such a phenomenon to have existed, there must have been a reason. Remember, as my grandfather used to, I never met my grandfather, but my father tells me, my grandfather used to say, there must be a reason for everything. So if you see an abnormality, look for the reason. And that's what I do, and that's what's gained me the conclusions I've gained. Now, let's take a sideways step for a second, because if we wind back to the sort of pre-60s revolution that changed society, I think we can look back at the sort of the hippie 60s, the 60s, it was this cultural revolution where the children stood up and said, Mum and Dad, I love you, but I don't necessarily believe in all the things you've been saying or doing anymore. And we've thrown out a lot of dogma that was wrong. But wait, may we have thrown out too much? So I see images here of people putting books and even glasses on their heads to increase their body posture. And I remember this thing where people would put apples on their heads as well. I kind of feel, you know, from a modern era looking back on this, this looks a little bit forced, a little bit staged, a little bit as if we are coercing people to do this, whether or not they want to, maybe society's coercing them. However, this was going on. This was almost normal within some groups, definitely normal. People were standing, you know, they were being taught good posture. You know, you even had books written, this book here, Make Correct Posture a Habit. So it was a whole movement within society to make people stand up well. And we have an image here I got from a Chinese airline that's trying to teach its airline hostesses good body posture. I don't think you would see this in a Western airline company. And that's an interesting discussion itself. You've also got here Miranda Kerr stepping out of a car. I mean, just exquisite poise and deportment that this girl's displaying here as she gets out the car. Now, interesting, she's another one of these individuals I've noticed brought up out in the back in a sort of mixed farming environment where, which I just think is very healthy for you. It's just anecdotal. But Miranda is getting out of this car with absolute exquisite poise and body posture. And that seems to have been ingrained right up till, well, I think the 60s phenomenon, when we had dramatic change and all of a sudden you wanted to be how you wanted to be and to slouch and to sit, that became cool. And this is, you know, what we're going to do. You didn't have to wear a tie to go to a meeting. You didn't have to wear a suit at the weekend for the certain classes and groups within the UK. Things started changing. And we come back to the why. Why were they there in the first place? Why did Victorian Britain and the relative parallel groups all around the world enforce on their children, and this appears to have gone from right down to the very poorest groups up to the very wealthiest groups, this idea of good body posture, both when you're eating, both in deportment, when you're moving around, to such a strict level? I mean, did people in this era not love their children as much as we do now? Did they not care? Why were they all being really very strict on their kids? You know, I've got some images of army recruits with pins in their lapels to keep them standing up straight. And apparently that was relatively common within the army. And of course, not long ago we had conscription. So it was a society-wide thing. What? Why? Because there's a reason for everything. Now, I take this image, circa 1920, from an artist who is depicting the village idiot. Now, in many ways, what's being described here is an adenoidal face. It's a very downswung face. It's a lengthened face. It's someone who's hung their mouth open like this. And I just remember my mother telling me, she would say, don't hang your mouth open because the wind will change and it will set like that. Or she would say, stop hanging your mouth open or you'll look like you'll become the village idiot. Now, who was the village idiot? Well, we've got this image here of the village idiot. And you've got this long face, almost an adenoidal face, flat cheekbones, almost certainly a decreased airway size. And of course, the idea, the inference behind this is that this person's not so intelligent. And I'm fascinated by images I got here. We've got Bush and we've got Obama. You know, so clearly you've got articles written. These images went with articles, both of which articles were particularly unflattering, giving the impression that both of these individuals were stupid. So they are looking similar to the village idiot, this sort of duh. And where did that duh concept come from? Well, I think the best reason I've come up with so far goes back to these, you know, wise traditions. And these wise traditions saying, sit up straight, shut your mouth, chew your food properly, and have good body posture and deportment. Stand straight, grow straight. And this is this concept behind it. And I think that we could probably say there's an element of truth to this. And I think we should sort of sum this up with the title of this book, Make Correct Posture a Habit. And of course, the younger the better. Get young children engaged. And my mission is prevention. I genuinely think that with some effort, we could prevent craniofacial dystrophy, the cause of crooked teeth and possibly sleep apnea and many other things. And as a society, this is clearly what we should be doing. So make correct posture a habit and prevent malocclusion.